Hi everyone, welcome to Gateway Lectures. Here we have solution for day 2 quiz, daily quiz, and this is your first question. A car travels around a horizontal circular track that has a radius of 100 meters if the car increases its speed at a constant rate of 2 meters per second square, starting from rest. The time needed for it to reach an acceleration of 3 meters per second square is? See, it is said here in question, constant rate of 2 meters per second square. But again they are asking the time needed for it to reach an acceleration of 3 meters per second square. Why is this acceleration being increased? You need to understand one thing. There was one key term mentioned in the question, from rest. So whenever the car starts from rest, suppose this is our starting point, let that be 1. And this is our point where it reaches an acceleration of 3 meters per second square here. Okay, whenever in circular motion, we'll have two types of accelerations. One is tangential acceleration and the other is radial acceleration. So always, we'll just solve this question. Always, A total is equal to A tangential plus A normal. Okay, tangential is along the tangent, it is nothing but along the periphery. And that tangential acceleration, the value will be given by R alpha plus the acceleration normal along the radial direction. This can be called normal or radial acceleration, and it is given by R omega square, and that is towards the center. So here it is said the car starts from rest. Whenever the car starts from rest, it is having only linear speed. It don't know that it is traveling on the circular path. But once the car starts from rest, as the position vectors start changing its direction, this is a position vector here and this is a position vector here. As the position vector starts changing direction, then the new component of acceleration will be obtained. That is nothing but radial or normal acceleration. So initially, no circular component or no radial component of acceleration. The acceleration total will be just the tangential acceleration. That is nothing but a linear direction along the tangent. That is given as R times alpha. Right. And that value is given initially as 2 meter per second square. From that we will get the value of alpha. So R alpha is equal to 2 meter per second square. From that alpha is equal to 2 by 100. Nothing but 0.02. R is given as 100 meters. So we'll calculate the alpha and we'll get it as alpha radian per second. And now this value is constant. For that constant acceleration, we'll be getting a constant acceleration. Okay, for this linear acceleration, we are getting a constant circular acceleration. Okay, as in circular motion, due to the position vector change, radial acceleration also develops with time. So initially, final condition is A total will be equal to A tangential plus A radial. Okay, and it is said what will be the time to reach a total acceleration of 3 meter per second square. They did not mention what is acceleration. He just simply mentioned acceleration. Then we need to take the total acceleration. So total acceleration is 3 meter per second square. That is equal to, actually these were vector quantities, so we will not directly write the magnitude. Okay, we will not directly write the magnitude. Instead, we know A total acceleration magnitude was known as 3, and A tangential, it is a constant value and it is known as 2. So from that we need to calculate the value of A radial. Okay, for that we can use A total is equal to under root of A tangential square, let this be small t, plus A radial square. This is known, 3, nothing but 3 square is equal to AT square is 2 square plus AR square. From that we will get the value of AR square is equal to 5. Okay, and from this AR is equal to under root of 5 meter per second square. We already discussed here that A radial or the value, its magnitude is R omega square. Okay, that also we can write as root 5 is equal to r omega square, we can also write it as v square upon r. Okay, from that we'll get the value of v as 14.953 meter per second. V is known, and here it is said the car starts from initially from rest. So initially it is at rest, u is equal to 0. Finally it is at a velocity of, this is a speed actually, this is a speed. 14.953 meter per second is the linear speed. That linear speed is, join this first and second point along this line. This is the direction of the linear speed we got here, and that value we got it as 14.953 meter per second, and it is along the tangent from that point. So the acceleration involved here is a tangential, and that value is equal to 2 meter per second square. Right, now we need to calculate time. U is known, v is known, a is known. Then by law of motions we can write v is equal to a plus a u plus at. U is 0, from that v is equal to a into t. From here t is equal to v upon a, nothing but v is 14.953 meter per second upon acceleration a is, the constant acceleration a is 2 meter per second square, the constant tangential acceleration here, a tangential. From that we will get the value of time as 7.476 seconds. Here why we have taken v, u and at is, whatever we are talking about speed, that is always tangential. If you take it, if you consider it at point 1 here, it will be along the tangent. If you consider some other point, it will be along the tangent. If you consider some other point, it will be along tangent. So finally it will reach a point, there also it will be tangential. So it changes with tangential acceleration. Here it is 0, but here it is having some velocity, that is 14.953 meter per second. Okay, in this way we can solve this question. The next question is, a bullet of mass 0.05 kg is fired from below into the bob of mass 0.45 kg of a long simple pendulum as shown in the figure. This is a long simple pendulum. Mean the length of the simple pendulum is so long. Okay, having a more length. The bullet remains inside the bob and the bob rises through a height of 1.8 meters. So after colliding with the bob, the bullet pierces into the bob and both together start moving to in the direction of the bullet, and they reach a height of 1.8 meters and then they come to rest. The speed of the bullet. Now here what is the speed of the bullet? So we need to calculate the speed of the bullet. Let the speed of the bullet be u, and let the speed at which these start moving upward is v. Okay, now we'll solve the equation. Here important thing to note is, this bullet, whatever traveling in the upward direction, is under gravity force, and the bob which is supported by a string is also under gravity force, right? Both were under a force, and here since both were under the same force, we can apply conservation of linear momentum. If suppose the bullet is having no effect of gravity, if it is having no effect of gravity, then we can't apply conservation of linear momentum here. But here both were having, from the initially they are having the gravity effect, we can apply conservation of linear momentum. So conservation of linear momentum, because it is said that conservation of linear momentum cannot be applied, conservation of linear momentum cannot be applied under the action of external forces. But here we can apply conservation of linear momentum. The initial velocity of the bullet is 0.05 times of u, and the bob is initially rest. So we need not take that component. And finally after collision of bullet with the bob, they both together travel with some velocity v. We already here discussed, we mentioned the velocities u and v. Okay, from that we'll get the value of v as u upon 10. So the combination of both bob and bullet will travel with 1/10 of the bullet speed. Now we'll take the FBD of the bullet, bullet and bob together. Not exactly FBD, we'll take the motion diagram of the bullet, and it is under a gravitational force, but it is traveling opposite to the gravitation, thus it is having deceleration of minus g. Right, here initially the bullet is having some velocity, one just after the collision, that is V. We've calculated here, U by 10. Finally, the bob and bullet system will get into rest due to deceleration. So we know the value of A, and also we know the value of S here, 1.8 meters. We know the final velocity. Then we relate them by V dash square is equal to U dash square plus 2AS. Okay. From here, V dash is 0 and U dash is, we've calculated already, nothing but V. So it is V square upon 100. Sorry, it is just a V square. It is just V square plus 2 into minus G into 1.8 meters. And we know the value of V is nothing but U upon 10. So it is U square by 100 minus 2 into the acceleration due to gravity here. For simpler calculation, we assume it as 10. It was not mentioned in the question. We assume it as 10, or we can even take for 9.81, but here we will take that value of 10 and we'll proceed to the solution. It was not mentioned in the question. And from here, by simplifying this, we'll get the value of U as 60 meter per second. And this is our answer. Right. Our third question. At the instant shown in the figure, at this instant exactly, 8.4 kg slender rod has an angular velocity of 6.9 radian per second and is subjected to a force of 6.6 newtons and a moment of 59 newton meter. If the rod length is 4 meter, what will be the angular velocity of the rod when it is rotating by 90 degrees downward, assuming the force is always perpendicular to the axis of the rod? Okay. And G is equal to 9.8 meter per second square. Right. Now we'll go into the solution here. So here we have calculated the mass moment of inertia. Mass moment of inertia can be calculated for a bar by, if it is a bar of length L and mass M, then mass moment of inertia about the center of mass is ml square by 12. But now we need to calculate the mass moment of inertia about the hinge. This is our hinge point. For that hinge point, we need to apply perpendicular axis, parallel axis theorem. So mass moment of inertia is I is equal to ml square by 12 plus m into the distance between the two axes is L by 2 to its whole square. Then the value we'll get as ml square by 3. Substituting the given values in the I, will get the final mass moment of inertia as 44.8 kg per meter square about the hinge. Now here, initial condition theta is equal to 0, we are having a omega naught value. The initial angular velocity is 6.9 radian per second. And for theta is equal to 0, if this is our datum, this is our datum or reference, then for datum or reference, HCOM is 0. At theta is equal to 90 degrees, this HCOM has shifted from this place to here. Right. For that, it would have consumed some potential energy, and that HCOM is nothing but L by 2. And this is our final condition. Now, energy conservation will be applying here. Mg into HCOM minus initial, what is datum? Initial HCOM is 0 since it is a datum, plus the moment. See, always moment into change in angle gives us the energy value. Okay. So moment, the moment was acting on the member as 59 newton meter given in the equation. So here moment plus force into length. This is also a moment due to force. Total multiplied by the change in angle is equal to the change in rotational kinetic energy. Nothing but half I omega 1 square minus omega naught square. Here M was known. G was also given. HCOM was known. Nothing but L by 2. Plus moment was known, force was known, length was known. The change in angle is 90 degrees, nothing but in radians pi by 2. Moment of inertia we've calculated. Omega naught square was given in the question as 6.9 radian per second. And finally left thing to calculate is omega 1. We'll substitute all the values here. And then finally we'll get the value of omega 1 as 7.807 radian per second. Next question, question number 4. A small mass starts sliding down an inclined plane from rest, which is making an angle 60 degrees with the vertical direction, not horizontal here. With the vertical direction, it is making 60 degrees angle. If the coefficient of friction depends on the distance x as mu is equal to 3x, the distance covered by the block on inclined plane of sufficiently long length when it stops is. So on the inclined plane with very high length, at what distance the block stops, due to, since as x increases, some the mu value also keeps on increasing, so somewhere it has to stop, so it is under deceleration. We'll just solve this question. So here is our block initially, and here it is given in question, angle is 60 degrees with the vertical, then it will be 30 degrees with horizontal. Okay, the block is here, it is at x is equal to 0, let it not be x, let it be some h is equal to 0, and here it is at h is equal to l, it had traveled a distance of l. Now we will apply the forces whatever being acted on the body. So the mg component will be mg cos theta along the normal direction, that is perpendicular normal direction, and perpendicular to the plane there is a normal reaction, and here is the frictional force, and here is the mg sin theta. And now the block is moving down with some acceleration, let that be a, actually it is a deceleration case. So now we'll write the net force along the movement of the block. So net force will be mg sin theta minus f, frictional force is nothing but mu into n, so mu into n is nothing but mg cos theta, that is a total net force being acted on the body to make it accelerate. And the force can be written as mass into acceleration, that is equal to m into m, you take common, then we'll get mg will take common, mg will take common, then we'll get sin theta minus mu into cos theta. Okay, m and m will be getting cancelled. From that we'll get the value of a as g into sin theta is nothing but sin 30 degrees, theta is this angle 30 degrees, minus mu is given as 3x into cos 60, and the value of cos 30 is 0.866. okay, sin 30 minus 3x into 0.866. acceleration mean the rate of change of velocity, right? Then velocity means rate of change of displacement. So acceleration can be written as double integral of dx square upon dt square is equal to g into sin 30 is 0.5 minus 0.866 into 3x. Okay, now since it is varying, see, if acceleration here is a function of x, because mu is a function of x, here our acceleration is also a function of x. Since it is a function of x, we can't directly write the value of a, so we need to take integration from throughout the length x. So we are applying integration here. On applying integration, d square x by dt square, that value we'll get it as dx upon dt, nothing but dv upon dt. Here we make a small correction. In question our mu is varying as x, so we need our whatever velocity or whatever change with respect to x, so we need to change the things here. I'm just rubbing this. We'll continue here. A is nothing but dv upon dt, so you multiply that by v and divide it by v. You know, v is nothing but dx upon dt, the rate of change of displacement. So you substitute one value of, you substitute the denominator value v as dx upon dt, then we'll get it as dv by dt into dt upon dx. So the dt and dt term will be getting cancelled, and finally we'll get dv upon dv, v into dv upon dx, that value is nothing but g into 0.5 minus 0.866 into 3 times of x, right? Now v into dv will be this side, and here we'll have g into 0.5 minus 0.866 into 3x into dx. Now we'll integrate on the both sides. Okay, from here we'll get, see here, if you observe, this block starts here with rest and finally the block will go to rest only. So initially it is at rest, finally also it is at rest. So from u is equal to 0 to v is equal to 0. So this completely will be equal to 0. Now here, anyhow, if it is 0, the g value will be going into the LHS, then it will also be multiplied, it will be divided with 0. So we need not take that term. Then on integration we will get this as 0.5x, and this integration limit is at x is equal to 0 to x is equal to L. Okay, so 0 point, we can write directly the value here, 0 to L, and here also 0.5L minus 0.8666 into 3L is equal to 0. And from that simplification we will get the value of L is nothing but 0.3849 meters. This is our answer. This is actually a simple question. Only thing, important step here is to convert the acceleration in terms of dx. And generally acceleration is a time function, but we need to convert into a space function. So that is why we make a simple simplification here. This is an important step. With this step everything will be easy after this step. Our next question, a force F is equal to 95 minus kt, so it is varying with time, is acting on a particle which starts from origin. Okay, it starts from origin, mean it starts from rest from the origin and moves along the x-axis. This is our x-axis. The particle after 26.5 seconds reaches the origin. So somehow together with force or with some manipulation, finally again the particle reaches the origin, that is x is equal to 0 after 26.5 seconds. So at t is equal to 0, it is at x is equal to 0. And again at t is equal to 26.5 seconds, it is at x is equal to 0. Then the value of the constant k will be, this is a somewhat lengthy but logical question. There is a probability we can get such type of questions in examination. So f is equal to 95 minus kt. Right. Here force is a function of time. So we everything, whatever variables we have, what all differentials we have, it should be a differential with respect to time itself. Here in our previous question, it is a function of x. So whatever we are having should be a, finally we should get it in a function of x. That is why we made a correction here. Right. So in this question, f is equal to 95 minus kt. And that value is nothing but mass into acceleration. And that can be written as m into d square x upon dt square. Right. From this, we can write d square. This is all mathematics, simple mathematics. So d square x upon dt square is equal to 1 by m into 95 minus kt. Now the differential is a differential is with respect to time, and also the variable function here is also with respect to time. So no need to do any simplification, we'll directly apply integration here. Here it is an indefinite integral because we don't know what the limits are, so it is an indefinite integral. So d square of x d square x upon dt square is nothing but dx upon dt, and this value is nothing but 1 by m into 95 into t minus kt square by 2 plus the constant of integration is c1. So we need to find the value of c1. For that we'll apply the boundary conditions. What is the boundary condition here? We know the block, the body starts with from rest, u is equal to 0, and also at x is equal to 0. So at x is equal to 0, u is equal to 0. This dx by dt is nothing but velocity v, nothing but velocity term. So at x is equal to 0, dx upon dt velocity is 0. By substituting that, we will get the value of c1 as 0. So c1 is equal to 0. Then our final equation is dx upon dt is equal to 1 by m into 95t minus kt square by 2. Again, it is a function of time here. Again, it is varying with time, the differential equation. So we'll integrate again. Finally, because here we need to calculate, see in this question, we need to calculate the value of k itself. So we need to apply differentiation as many times as possible to get the value of k. So dx upon dt integral is equal to 1 by m minus phi. And when we integrate this, then we'll get dx upon dt integration nothing but x is equal to 1 by m into 95 t square by 2 minus k t cube upon 6 plus c2. Okay, again we'll apply boundary conditions to calculate the value of c2. Again, here the boundary condition is at t is equal to 0, x is equal to 0, we know that. At initially time 0, the body is at origin. So from that, we'll get the value of c2 as again 0. And now our final equation is x is equal to 1 by m 95 t square by 2 minus k t cube upon 6. Okay, this is our final equation of x with respect to time. And our final condition is given in the question at t is equal to 26.5 seconds. Again, the body is at origin, so the x is equal to 0. We'll substitute that in our equation, and here we will get our final answer 96.5 whole square upon 2 minus k into 26.5 whole cube divided by 6. From this we will get the value of k on simplification as 10.755. Okay, and this is our answer for this question. Thanks for watching. Still there are many important questions on this subject, but we've decided to make it simple and short. So we are uploading 5 questions daily for daily quiz. It will be very easy to learn 5 questions daily. So I hope you are enjoying these daily quiz lectures. Stay tuned. Many subjects will be dealt. All the mechanical subjects, daily we'll take one subject. We'll do quiz on that. Thanks for watching.